Niles, First Christian Church, Disciples of Christ. Welcome to the body of Christ made manifest in some small portion here in our gathering, in our worship, in our anticipation. And I'm sure we are bursting with anticipation in the moment. The time is upon us. I know we've been very cautious not to let any Christmas hymns slip past our lips. I know that we have been cautious not to celebrate yet this Christmas season, but it is upon us. It is upon us, and we are ready. The beauty of this season is no matter how prepared or underprepared we are, if we've wrapped up all of our presents, the season comes. Christ comes for us whether we are ready or not. Here in this season, we can celebrate that we might never be ready if it was left to ourselves. But the presence of the divine goes before us, opens up this world in miracles, allows us to experience each other and the divine in ways that we might not have thought possible otherwise. So be present for this. Be present in these moments and see how God is working. We invite you, of course, not only to be here this morning, but to be here this evening as we gather for our Christmas Eve candlelight service at 7 p.m. If you are one of the readers, we invite you, if you're here right now, you can stick around after worship. We're going to set up the sanctuary for the Christmas Eve service. Or if you can come here about 6 o'clock, we can make sure to walk through everything and have that all ready and set. We also invite you to our Christmas Day service of lessons and carols. It's a classic service that moves through the stories of the infancy narrative that sings some of our favorite Christmas hymns, and we celebrate communion with cookies. So I don't know if that's a good sale point for y'all, but if you haven't been here, we invite you to be here Christmas morning at 10 a.m. It's a short service, enough time that you can be here after you open the presents and enough time to get back to get the ham started. But we invite you to be here for that. If you can't make it, of course, we invite you to live stream it. We have it on Facebook and we upload it to YouTube later in the day. So if you just need your fix of Christmas carols and you need it with the community of Niles First Christian, we invite you to be a part of that as well. And of course, to come next week as we continue the Christmas season, because tomorrow is only the beginning of the Christmas season. It's the day one of the 12 days of Christmas. You know that because of that song where that guy buys that girl way too many birds, right? It's a season to celebrate. So next Sunday, we celebrate Christmas as well. We're going to look at a Christmas hymn sing. So if you didn't happen to get any of those favorite hymns from the hymnal out during the season, it's a wonderful opportunity to share those as well. With all this being said, is there anything else that we could... Yes, I do have another couple announcements that were given to me. We do have Tuesday. If you are looking for ways to celebrate this Christmas season as acts of service, we invite you to connect with Becky about the Youngstown Rescue Mission dinner that's being served Tuesday from 4:45 to 7. I think we have enough folks for that, but if you are planning on bringing a dessert, the office is going to be closed Tuesday, so if you can bring them in tonight, make sure they're in the fridge, or get them to Becky Carpenter directly. There's not going to be any Bible study this Tuesday, but other than that, we are going to continue as we normally do. Is there anything else that we have to name in the community this morning? Then may we move into our worship by lighting our Advent wreath. O Emmanuel, Rex et Ligifer Noster, Expectatio gentium et salvator erum, veni ad salvadam nos domine dus noster. O Emmanuel, our King and our Lawgiver, the hope of the nations and their Savior, come and save us, O Lord our God. Here we light the candle of love, the final, save one, of the Advent wreath. Only the Christ candle goes unlit as we await those final moments to usher in the incarnate child, Emmanuel, God with us. Though we still anticipate, though we still wait, the gifts of the Christ are already upon us. We have kept these gifts of hope, peace, joy, and love within our hearts, and in our lives lived out throughout these darkened days of Advent. But none shine as brightly as love. The greatest of these is love. love illuminates lives and spirits. It crosses boundaries and thresholds. It embraces friend and stranger alike. It is the love as of a parent to a child, as the God above all come down to save. It burns brightly in the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it. As the light of love has been given to you, let it shine brightly that all may be warmed by its presence, and that the miracle of Christmas might be known to all. I invite us to sing together, "One Candle Is Lit," verse 4. Together in the call to worship. The time is nearly upon us. Our preparation is almost over. Anticipation overflows. As the darkness grows around us, the illumination that brings light, love, and understanding to the world is nearly come. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In this one of the darkest nights, let us remember that this Word, this light, took on humanity to live with us and within us. In the fullness of time, the Word became the Lamb of God, the sacrifice for our sins. Then come, let us worship in spirit and truth, that we might know this one who came to save us, who is here with us, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to rise, if you are willing and able, for our opening hymn, "Like a Child."
That is not the opening hymn, it is Emmanuel. Emmanuel.
We'll sing it once and then we'll repeat it. Thank you, Bonnie.
You to be seated. And may we share in this time that which we wish to bring forth to community, our joys, our concerns, that which we celebrate, that which we mourn, that we might be one in community and lifting each other up and in celebrating with one another. What is it that we have to offer this morning? Carol? Oh, Richard has COVID. Okay. Thank you, Carol. Jen. Oh, wonderful. What's his name?
Riker.
So we welcome into the world this new nephew in NICU, Riker. So we keep him in our prayers as well. Howie.
Prayers for the family and John Davies.
Yeah. Prayers for the family and John Davies in his passing. Georgianne. Continued prayers for son John and healing. Thank you.
For the Kepker family and the passing of Pam.
For the Kepker family and the passing of Pam. Next door neighbor, Ida Sella, in our prayers, who was diagnosed with colitis.
Can you pray for my brother Phil?
For Felix. For Felix and multiple health concerns. Dale. Shaley got a message from Stephanie over the week. Basically, she has multiple fractures in left foot and one fracture in the right foot. Surgery in 2 days off of her. No wait for at least 4 weeks. See what happens next. I let them know the casserole committee was lined up and ready to go, but we haven't. I haven't gotten the green light for that yet. Anything else we can name this morning? Praises that we're almost there. It's an exciting time, right? Faith knows. We're almost there. There's always things that need done. I'm sure that there's still presents to wrap. I'm sure that our readers tonight are a little trepidatious. I'm sure there's still ham preparation that needs to be made or whatever side that you're bringing, but Christmas comes. What is it the doctor said? Seuss said it comes without ribbons, packages, and bows. It comes without us or with us. May we be prepared and present. I invite us then to join together in an attitude of prayer, bringing forth what has been named to us as well as that which goes unnamed, that we might name them to our Creator, who certainly He knows and hears us, who has heard our voice before we were knitted in the womb, but that in naming them we might be those co-agents of creation that move for healing, that move for compassion and kindness. I then invite you to hear the morning prayer and to join together with me in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. We give you thanks in this place, but not just here. We strive in each moment to recognize your presence as you abide with distraught and feel alone. And when we are surrounded by a community of support and love, we know that in each of those times you go with us, for this is your promise to us of abiding care, of life fulfilled beyond our imagining. We give you thanks for the gifts that you have bestowed upon us, that you have given us. We give you thanks for this life that we experience, though it is not all joy. We are alive. And we have promises of what our life will look like because we abide in your care. We give you thanks that you have revealed yourself, O God, through the person of the Christ, incarnate one, Emmanuel, God with us. We give you thanks for the ways that you have revealed his nature to us, that we might understand that he is King of kings and Lord of lords, that we might hear again the promise of the high priest, intermediary to you, O God. We give thanks as we recognize his sacrifice for us, that something about Christ in life, in teaching, in death, and in resurrection brings us back to you, allows us to have intimate relationship with you, our Creator, who lives with us and among us. We give you thanks for the mystery of the Incarnation, for this divine present which has so shaped the world. Allow us to enter in again to that Christmas promise, to be present with you, O God, as we go about our days, the presence of the present of life. We give you thanks. In this season of anticipation, moving rapidly to celebration, might our thoughts, our views, all that we are, be drawn to you, O God, to the Nativity, to the teachings, to the cross, and to the empty tomb. For in the beginning of this birth story is a promise of death and of resurrection. In the beginning of the Incarnation is the hope of lives fulfilled beyond and overflowing to what we can imagine. There is a promise, even in the darkest days, of light and illumination. There is a promise that comes from you through your Son, O God, that allows us, in the darkest days of our lives, to find hope and healing, and a promise of better tomorrows. Allow this community to be the kingdom lived out. Allow us, as we gather in this place, to recognize that the kingdom is here because Christ has come. Though we celebrate it once a year for a season, we know that it is an eternal promise, O God, and we abide in that hope and in that promise. Allow our actions, then, to be reconciled with what you call us to do. Where we have faltered, where we have served ourselves, where we have failed, draw us back to you, O God. Forgive us as we seek forgiveness, and bring us back to you and to this community in all things, that we might bring you the gift of our lives, that you may be glorified, that you might be honored. Indeed, we use our words to bring you praise and glory as we lift up that which you have prayed to God. As we use our voices in unison to pray that prayer that Christ has taught us, and we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May we hear again from our choir, A Tiny Child Will Come. by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' and as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" And John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptizing. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." May God add a blessing to this and every reading of God's holy word. I invite us again to an attitude of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the revelation of those who have gone before us, for the baptizer who declares that this is surely the Son of God, for the Magi who in gifts denote the nature of who Christ is and what Christ means to us, for those strong of faith in this community and beyond that have lent their witness and their strength of narrative, allowing us to become who we are. In all things, then, may our lives reflect those faithful in our midst. May they reflect God's love poured out upon us. Indeed, may all that we say and think and act towards you, towards all creation, and towards each other be of the kingdom and pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We've almost made it. We've almost made it. We've made it through the gifts, at least. We've talked about the Magi's gifts for the past several weeks. We know that the gold of the Magi's is representative of what? Kingship. The gold was representative that, right, the gifts might not have been literally given to Jesus, but they're representative of the nature of the Christ. Gold is representative that Christ is King, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The frankincense is representative of what? Priesthood. Now, if y'all pay real close attention, you'll notice that in the prayers and in everything else that I'm doing up here, I'm giving you little hints. Frankincense is something that is used in worship services that denotes that Christ is the high priest of Christianity, explained in Hebrews as the one who intercedes on our behalf, who works for us, that we might be heard. Myrrh is really the odd standout in these three. It's an odd gift to give a baby because in much of the culture of the time, it represented death. An odd gift to give in celebration of new birth, something that represents death. We don't see this common. I have yet to receive some embalming fluid or a is, I would be reticent to invite them back if I did receive something like that. Why would they give this gift then? Maybe we need to figure out what we know about the Magi to let us know a little bit more about why they would give a child myrrh, an embalming fluid. Well, what do we know about the Magi? Well, we can look to the creche for hints. We see them, where are they hiding over there? We got one right here, three over here. I appreciate that they're making their way because they're not yet there. We hear them in the infancy narratives that they show up, maybe not while Jesus is still an infant, but maybe several years after. They show up maybe 3 years later to Jesus' house. I understand that. I'm not going to judge them. I'm still working on a baby blanket for my niece who's like 10. So I understand how that can happen. They showed up late, bringing gifts, representative of who Jesus would become. We know that Magi says something about their status in class. Magi is a root that, actually it's the same root that we get magic from. They were known as magicians. They were known as astrologers. They were known as the priestly class of Zoroastrianism, which was one of the major world religions of the time. It was the religion of Babylon and much of Persia. It's still practiced today if you want to look up Zoroastrianism. It's a really interesting, unique conceptualization and worldview. But we know that these holy men and women would have been those that discerned from stars, because astrology and astronomy was kind of the same thing then. They followed paths and could figure out portents and signs. So you'd think they'd be able to give better gifts, these wise people. I did hear a joke, and I have to fit a joke in here. How do we know that the Magi were male? Had they asked for directions, they would have been on time. They would have cleaned the stable, they would have brought a casserole, and they would have given legitimate, authentic, practical gifts. Now, I challenge that as well, because here's the fun thing. For a lot of my work into this and research into this, for years, I always thought the priest class would have been male, just because it was they were surrounded by a male-dominated society. But Zoroastrianism at the time actually had a lot of room for females in the priestly class. So there's a good chance that the Magi that showed up, if this is historically accurate, there's a good chance that some of them could have been female. So I guess there's no excuse for them showing up late. I don't know. They had the MapQuest directions printed out, but they made one wrong turn and they had to throw them away. That's an old joke. That joke doesn't work anymore. No one uses MapQuest like that. Nah. So, okay, that doesn't tell us much about why they gave myrrh. Maybe we need to look into what myrrh is. Myrrh is a resin. Like frankincense, it's a resin that comes from trees. If you scrape the bark off of trees, maybe you see this in pine trees in your backyard. If there's a spot where the bark has been damaged, there's a resin that develops that you can peel off. It's the same in some trees. This tree that we get myrrh from actually grows in the Arabian Peninsula. But it had been known in antiquity for millennia as a highly valued substance. It was a resin, it's an oleoresin, it's a blend of aromatic oils and resin, which is extracted from mostly trees in the Arabian Peninsula at the time. It's a natural gum, and like frankincense, it could be used as a type of incense. And in fact, the incense that I have is a mixture of frankincense and myrrh that you can smell it. I'm not going to burn it in here because I know I'll get anonymous complaints. But in ancient times, myrrh was more valuable than gold. Not just because of how it was used, but because of its many different properties and functions. It was more precious than gold, first of all, because it could only be harvested in certain areas and had to be distributed far across the developed world in this time. It was commonly used, even in about 1500 BCE, before the Common Era, before Jesus. It was used as an antibiotic, really, without recognizing germ theory. It was recognized as something that could keep sickness and illness at bay. And it was recognized as a preservative. So it would be used in a bunch of different ways. It could be used dissolved in water and either or used as a salve that would prevent infection, that would keep folks healthy. It was used as an embalming fluid, as well as an incense. So it could be burned, it could be turned into a poultice or a salve, it could be watered down, it could be applied in a bunch of different ways. It was a very useful thing to have on hand, which is why it was more valuable than gold. Most specifically, it was used in embalming, most famously perhaps, it was used in embalming bodies in Egypt. Showing proof of how effective myrrh is, you've seen mummies, or at least pictures of mummies, right? And you can see how well they are preserved. Salt is a big part of that, but myrrh was also part of the embalming process. Still a terrible gift to give to a child. Because myrrh is associated with death, not with new life. There must be something more to this. How do we understand myrrh as a gift that is given? Uh-oh. All right. So imagine there is a perfect illustration of what I'm talking about. Myrrh is equal to death. We hear in John's proclamation this morning in our scripture reading why myrrh would have been given to a new infant in celebration of life. We have, and this is the first time that John the Baptist showed up in our Advent. Usually he shows up a few times. He makes big appearances during Advent and during Lent. He comes here telling us to set paths straight and prepare for the day of the Lord. He tells us tomorrow, oh hey. He tells us during Lent, repent you brood of vipers. He is an interesting figure that loves to tell people how it is. We still hear it today in what John the Baptist calls us to. But we hear in our scripture reading for this morning, as John was recognizing, first of all, this is a really unique reading. In John, it's the only scripture in the Gospels where John does not physically baptize Jesus, because there's all kinds of issues with one who is blameless and sinless being baptized. And the Gospel authors try and deal with it in different ways. It's a great subject for Sunday school, for Bible study. But we'll say here at least that the Gospel of John doesn't have John the Baptist. I know I'm saying John a lot, different Johns, follow me. John doesn't have Jesus baptized by John the Baptist. Instead, we have this recognition from John the Baptist that here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. He saw the Spirit descend. And in seeing the Spirit descend, John the Baptist recognizes that in this person of Yeshua of Nazareth is the anointed one of God, the Messiah that has been predicted and anticipated and awaited for so, so long. But still, that Messiah would have been expected to be one who was a triumphant military leader. He would have been expected to be one who kicks out the Romans in all their grandeur and glory and reestablishes the Davidic kingdom, God's kingdom in Jerusalem and in the Holy Land. One that would spread until it encompassed the entire world. An empire not built by might or by coercion or by force, but by love. They would have expected this Messiah to be a military leader who was triumphant, who succeeded. Certainly not one who would die as a criminal. There's a problem with some of our Christmas celebrations. We are right in recognizing that here the story changes, that the Christ event, that the life, the teaching, the death, and resurrection have come about in ways that save this world from its fallen nature, ourselves from our own fallen states. But in celebrating, we sometimes miss that a necessary part of having the creche out front is that there is a cross behind us and an empty tomb beyond it. The Christmas story has no significance and no meaning if it does not take into account the Easter story that follows. Life, our lives, the gift that we have been given by the divine comes at great price and high cost. Certainly that which is much more valuable than gold or frankincense us to the value. Though they point us to the significance of who the Christ is and why we follow, the gift that has been given to us is so much more valuable. This is the power of this great gift exchange. We have been given our lives. We have been given so much. The lives that we have been given is God's gift to us. We draw breath this morning. Some of us woke up with our regular aches and pains and found it a little bit difficult to recognize that this is a blessing. We're all there sometimes. Maybe we're caught up in the hecticness of what still needs done. I'm sure our checklists are just as long, or if not longer, than they are at different times of the year. We get so caught up with the minutiae, with the bustle, with expectations, with our emotions. We sometimes forget that this is such a gift. Not just to be alive, not just that we have been animated by God's breath in our lives, by that ruach, that pneuma, that mighty wind, the divine breath that animates us and gives us breath. That is worth celebrating as it is. But this gift exchange, we have received far more than we have given. For in this gift, we have life abundant. Not only do we have life here and now, not only do we give thanks for each breath that we draw, as it has been inspired and given to us by our Creator, but by recognizing how Christ has lived, by seeing how Christ has taught, by following the life and the death and the resurrection of our Lord, we see a path for how we can live our lives. We have been given life, certainly, and in response, we emulate the Christ. We give of ourselves, though we might never be high priest because the job's already taken, though we might never be King of Kings and Lord of Lords, thank God, that sacrifice is still a gift that we get to take on. Each of us have a little bit of myrrh in our systems. Each of us have been preserved by the Holy Spirit. And in this, we have a life that is no longer ours. While it is still God's gift that we draw breath each day, by following the Christ child and following the life and teachings, by following the death and by coming, it turns to the resurrection, we as well experience life anew. Something I say in almost every funeral that I've had the opportunity to officiate. By celebrating a death like his, by dying ourselves in a death like his, we certainly are brought into resurrection like his. In baptism, we give away our old selves, and we take on a new life. By committing ourselves to the one who came for us, God made flesh incarnate, Emmanuel, God with us, we set aside so much of our ambitions, our hopes, and our dreams, and we recognize that our lives are to be lived out to be a blessing unto others. Just as Christ transformed this world in unexpected ways, so we too, with our small gifts of generosity, of kindness, of love, of hope, of peace, of joy, and of love poured out into this creation, have magnificent ramifications. Indeed, we are co-creators with our God who bring forth, in some small ways, the kingdom of God in its entirety. What a beautiful gift we have been given to give to others. All we're doing here is re-gifting. This is not our gift to give, but it has been given to us. And frankly, I think some of the best gifts are those that are re-gifted. The ones that mean more to the person being handed on. Things can become brighter. Things can become better. Things can become more dignified and more worthy as they are passed along. We are the re-gifts of God's creation. It is a sacrifice of ourselves. But the world is made so much brighter because of it. So in the gifts that you have been given, don't keep them to yourself. In the gifts of life, greatness of your existence, let it be found as a worthy gift to others. May you yourself be a gift that someone unwraps this year. Might the world be a better place because of it. Amen. I always enjoy gathering around this table because it puts life into perspective for me. I, along with one or two other folks, actually a community of folks that change weekly, make sure this table happens. Like, I bake the bread. We have a wonderful team that puts together our communion packets. And sometimes when things go wrong, I think to myself, I didn't do this at my table right. And that's when things get shifted for me. Yeah, this isn't my table. This isn't mine to invite you or to disinvite you. This table has been set for us for millennia. It is a place where all are welcome. Where somehow, no matter how poorly the leadership team, me, screws up, the table is still available. There's enough bread and there's enough juice. Indeed, there's enough here to sate even the strongest hungers and thirst. It is because we serve one who constantly provides for us in abundance. Indeed, if we dwell in the realm of God, which is already but not yet, we set aside our scarcity mentalities and celebrate the abundance that comes in the kingdom of God. So embrace and partake, because this season comes whether we're ready or not. This table is prepared whether we're ready or not. The providence and the presence of God is here whether we are ready or not. The most we can do at times is to be present and to share bread with one another, finding the path that is set for us, one of salvation, of atonement, of grace and reconciliation. So may I hand on to you the way that it has been handed on to me, that on the night that Jesus last ate with friends and with family, with those that would deny him, those that would betray him, still he welcomed them in, and he took a loaf of bread, and after having blessed it, he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat it, eat in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup, and after having blessed it, said, "This is the cup of the new covenant shed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, drink in remembrance of me." For as often as we have the opportunity to gather, as often as we have the opportunity to break bread with one another, to share a cup, to tell stories of how God has been present in our lives, to be present with one another as we seek to serve, every time we do one of these things, we proclaim that we are of this new realm. And we preach this good news until Christ comes for us again. So I invite you with what you have to take bread and to partake as Christ's body broken for you. And in like fashion to take cup as Christ's blood shed for you.
Let us pray. This is a magical day. God with us has come to touch our world, our lives. God with us has come to bring us out of darkness into a glorious light. God with us invites us to come to the table, believing in the promises of God fulfilled. Here we hear angels and see shepherds and are transformed by a baby. Here love is offered and love is found in the sharing of this bread and grape. Here we find our journey's end and its beginning. Amen.
Amen.
sing with the angels to celebrate the tremendous gift of your Son. We rejoice with gladness you give us. Wonderful joy and peace of our Savior, may we exalt. As we bring our offerings, we ask that our lives would reflect it to yours as your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I invite us to rise.